So Lucy Molenke is a good friend of mine from Nairobi, Kenya, and I've worked with her for a number of years now. And she is a co-founder of the Indigenous Women's Biodiversity Network. And so when I first met Lucy, I'm not sure what country we were in, I think Brazil. I think we were in Brazil, and it was for a big United Nations meeting, and I got funded as a Pacific participant to come and share some of what we were experiencing here in Hawaii, and some of my mo'olelo was about GMOs in Hawaii, because for me, being from Kauai, we were seeing a lot of that impact on our land and in our community. So that was part of the story that I went to share in Brazil and to learn how we can become a voice at this international level. And so Lucy, she started many years before me, but she quickly pulled me into the core group and said, hey, you gotta help me organize these women. And by then, her and another friend from Panama, her name is Florina Lopez, and this is back in 1998 when they first started the Women's Biodiversity Network. And they felt that it was, they saw a big need for having a voice for not only women in general, but for Indigenous women, to really be able to share our stories and to be visible at a global level. So thanks to their leadership, they've held this network together, and slowly we've been growing and adding on younger people. At the time, I was young. Now she says I'm getting older, so we need younger people. And so as you can see, we try to pick some really young ones. So that's kind of how we started to work together, and a lot of our interactions have been at global meetings that have happened around the world. And when I knew that the IUCN meeting was going to be held here in Hawaii, I quickly wrote to her and said, hey, we need to fundraise a little bit, and we need to find some funding so that we can bring women to Hawaii. And I always wanted to host them here in Hawaii and let them see the beauty of our aina here. And so luckily we were able to do that. And in the planning, I said, well, we gotta go to Moku o Wai'anae. You know, you cannot come to Oahu and not see the beauty of our island, including Moku o Wai'anae, which has become a big part of my life. Especially because of our partnership. So we dedicated, we didn't even go to the convention center today because I said, no, we gotta take our time and go Malie out to the coast. You can see the beauty. And then luckily Paula had jumped in with us and she had shared with us. We took them to the end of the road and tried to share some of the wahipana in the area as well as some of the good food. So we went to Ma'o Farms. Our visit there was way too short because they had so many questions when we left. And then we went to Kahumana Farms and we had food. And we just ate a few hours ago. So they're like, you're always feeding us. I said, welcome to Hawaii. This is Yeshing Juliana Upún. And she is a Mayan woman from Guatemala. And this is the first time I've met her. So actually, you know, you show up at the airport and you looking at the picture like, is that her? I wonder if that's her. But yeah, so Juliana works with an association called Sotzil, and did I pronounce it wrong? Sosil. And we've Skyped many times and we've emailed many times, but we never met in person until she arrived here in Hawaii. So you'll be hearing more about her work with her organization and their women and the spirituality and projects that they do in their community.
Sekere wonohel handaben kikotri wanima yuma ingo ivgenchish konohel handaben matyoshichcheri qatit khamama ruma shuyaq ichke ingo babe ivgenchi konohel. Thank you very much for give me this opportunity to be here and to share a little bit about my culture. It's really a pleasure for me, and I want to thank my ancestor also to allow me to be here in this sacred territory. First of all, I want to introduce myself. My name is Yeshing Juliana Upún Yos. I am a Mayan Kaqchikel woman, one of the 24 indigenous people from Guatemala. And my name, Yeshing, it means in my culture a title that give us that we give us to a woman that made a very good work in the community. But of course, I'm just growing up. I would like to talk about how important it's for us to use, to manage and conserve our territories. That's for that reason we would like to share a little bit about our traditional knowledge. I'm working in an organization that's called Sotil. Sotil, it means like some related with bath, because it's bath is really important for us in our culture. And in my region, it's really special for that reason. My organization is an indigenous organization. It's called Sotil. This is our territories. If you see each point, it's where the indigenous peoples live. And most of the map that I show you, it's still forest, a lot of forest, because for us it's so important to conserve our forest. And in our culture, it's very, very important for us to conserve biodiversity, because we have epistemology, our own epistemology and our worldview. And this led us to integrate biodiversity in our life, in our daily life, because we consider that we need biodiversity to survive. We need all each element that is so very important for us to be indigenous people, because it's part of our identity. This is just a picture. We work with a group of women. We try to make some activities how to recover our traditional knowledge. As you see, they are preparing the land. They made some organic, we don't use chemical, we just use organic, yes. And they are preparing because they will use it for reforest our territories, and they will prepare the land, and they help a collective way. And also, it's very important for us to work about our traditional knowledge and how to teach the children that each element that are in our territories have life. We have to respect trees, we have to respect birds, we have to respect all the land, because we are part of the Mother Earth. The Mother Earth gives us life. If we kill each element, we kill ourselves. And we need that each element have to be in our territories. And also, if we conserve our forest, we can also have this, our river. This really, we need water to survive. And for that reason, we have to take care for forest, we have to take care for water, for everything. You see, it's really beautiful. It's part of our land. And also, this is part of our spirituality. We have our own spirituality as a Mayan culture. We still practicing with children, with women, with all the people, because we consider that it's very important to thank our ancestor for everything that we receive. We have our own calendar. We have several calendar, Mayan calendar, and we also try to show to the children, and we use it in our clothes. Like you see in my, I don't know how to say, but for us it's huipil. Huipil is like a t-shirt, but it's really special for us. We call huipil, and we have each element that have my huipil. It's part of the biodiversity. We have like some part of the trees, some part of the fruits, and every day we have one of the calendar that we use have each month have 20 days, and each day have their name, and each day have their own energy. And for example, this one, it is the day when I was born, and I have my own energy. And every day we have to thank if it's for the moon, if it's for the sun, if it's for the animals. We each day have their own special day to thank for everything that they give us in our life. And for that reason, we prepare a special ceremony to thank for every day. Of course, that maybe we can do something like that every day, but we have a special date that we have to thank with all the communities. And this is part of our biodiversity. All these birds we have in our forest, and we have to take care of this because also they help us with the pollination to keep our life. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Juliana. And actually, I should start calling her Yeshing because she thought it would be easier if we call her Juliana, a more common name, but she told us her native, her indigenous name is Yeshing, so I should be calling you Yeshing.
Yes, okay.
Anyways, so thank you so much for your story. And you know, I think I saw a lot of people nodding their heads like, oh yeah, that's the same for us. So I just wanted to see maybe if there was any mana'o or questions, any ninao about what Yeshing shared. Yes. That's okay. You know what? Maybe you mind coming to the mic because we're videotaping. So. Thank you.
So I was wondering, what is the economy like in Guatemala? Or at least the area that you're in, because from what I'm gathering on what you're saying is you had massive deforestation, and I'm not exactly sure what kind of industry outside of course forestry, but what else is happening in Guatemala, and why is it that your children have disconnected from their past?
Sorry, I know. There are so many, so many questions, but in Guatemala we have a very special situation of about our economy. But of course, that for the communities, we depend of our territories, of the government or the state. They have another kind of, or another system of how to attend all the needs that the communities has. But we have our own way to survive. We depend on biodiversity, because for that reason we have to take care, and in a sustainable way. We can't use everything, and then we can. we can use everything, but we can't take care. We have to produce more. If you take one tree, we have to plant three or four or more. Yeah. What is your other question?
So the other question was about why is it that the young ones, like, why is it so important for you to do these projects with the families? Has there been something that created a disconnect? Like, maybe a lot of them are not interested in learning the traditional ways because of technology, or why do you feel it's important for them to learn?
Okay, yeah. We have a problem, for example, in the system of education, because when you go to school, the school is disconnected to your community. And sometimes when you go to school, you must have to learn about another things, and not the things that you relate to your community, how you can to relate all the contents that the schools have. They don't take care about this. For that reason, we want that the people for the community have to still teach to the children and teach to the people. That is very important, and also technology. Now, many of our practices, we are trying to still practice because of the, for example, if some family have television, most of the children they go and look some other things, but when I heard about the story of my mother or a story of my father, they give us another example of life. They have stories that will help us in our life, in our future. Don't do that, don't do this, and because of this, it's based on their experience. And of course, we don't want to be disconnected to the technology. We need it, but we have to use for ourselves to keep our identity, to use it for us, right?
Thank you. I think we have time for one more question. Yes. Yeah, she attended our Ai Malama workshop the other day, and they were 4 hours worth of it. But yeah, that's a good question, because I was interested in that too. Like you said, you had 20 moons in a month.
Yeah.
And like for Hawaiian, remember Kalei shared that there's 30 moons in 1 month. So
yeah.
Tell us more about the lunar calendar.
Okay. Well, we have our calendar for the agriculture. Most for agriculture, we see when the moon, it's how to say, it's born, or it's and it depends. We use for all our practice, and for agriculture, for example, and for when we have to. If we going to cut some tree, when we can do it, when not, we cannot do it, and when can we go to the forest, when can't go to the forest, but it depends of the day, and it depends for of course that it's really difficult for me. I'm not so good in to speak in English, but I'm trying to say about every day for us. Every day has its own energy. It depends of the energy, because in our culture we also see the moon when someone is. How to say, when for pregnant, we can use it for many practices, but we have our calendar for the year. For the moon calendar has 360 days, and we have 5 days for just for to do reflection.
Yeah.
Just 5 days. We will have 365. But for doing our work, for doing everything, we just take 360 in our lunar calendar.
Thank you. Maybe later we'll be able to share a little bit more. Maybe one more round of applause for Yeshing.
Thank you.
And I think our... I was gonna say that's really interesting, her answer, because for Hawaiians we have 360 days too, and the other 5 days, I've been just as I'm learning more about the lunar calendar too, the other 5 days comes every so many years, and we put in a 13th month, and that's called a Malama Pili or a Malama Ukali. And Kalei Nu'uhiva, as we all know, is one of our experts in Kaulana Mahina, and she was just teaching us a little bit more about that. I'm not an expert at it, but learning more about it. So that's something really interesting, because our Gregorian calendar is 365 days, but so like you, for Native Hawaiians, our lunar calendar is 360 days too, because 30 days for each month or malama. Okay, so the next presenter is from Chiang Mai, Thailand, and she's from the Karen people.
Sawadika. Sawadika is mean hello in Thai. So my name is Mudanawanat is my full name. I'm a Karen ethnic minority, so it's the biggest of the ethnic minority in Thailand. And now I am working for Mekong Youth Assembly. So Mekong Youth Assembly, Mekong is the name of a river in our region through past six countries. So I work with the youth and the children six countries. We focus on the human rights and the environmental issue. And another one, I work with the DCCN Development Center for Children and Community Network. This one, I focus on the stateless people. Do you have stateless here? No, right? Yeah, in Thailand, we have a lot. Because I would like to tell a little bit about my story. My family is from current state in Myanmar, so another country, not in Thailand. At that time, they have a civil war, so that's why they have to move to Thailand. So when they walk to Thailand and they stay in a rural area, small village, so in Thailand. So I was born in Thailand, that's why I became a stateless children. So I take around 10 years to fight for Thai nationality. Yeah, so now I became, I get the Thai nationality. So today I'm very happy because when I know that I will come to Hawaii, so my friend very happy to me. They said that you have to go to see the local people. In the schedule, I didn't see we have this schedule. So that's why I take three more days to stay, we'll stay here because of the schedule we finish 10. So I book the homestay 3 more days. I think that I would like to stay with the local people and we'll talk, we exchange culture, we exchange local knowledge. I think that is very important for me. And a lot of the story, my friend said that. And I think that the place here is a very nice, a very beautiful place. And how to say, very expensive as well. So I'm not sure that if I not taste this town to stay with the local people, but I never know that when I will come again. So I'm very lucky, so yes. So today I will share about the traditional knowledge through my experience and my life. Since I remember that, my mom told me that when I was born, my mom said that my dad take my, how do you call that? Umbilical cord, right? Yes, so they take my umbilical cord to keep on the tree. Yeah, you can see that. So everyone, for Korean people, when they get birth, they will keep it on the tree. So they said that when I grew up, I have to protect this tree because this tree, they have a spirit. So, they have to protect them and not allow anyone come to cut my tree. So that the thing I remember that. And another thing that, because I said earlier, I said that I grew up in a rural area, so my village has no electricity, of course, no television. So every year, every night before I go to bed, so I, like, you know, for the tele or poem, is a kind of like a, how to say, like a drama, you know. If I didn't get any story yet, I cannot sleep, so I will ask every night, like, mom, can you have a tales for me, or can you have a poem for me, you know, like, yeah, so all the story that we link with about the local spirit, about the river, about the forest, about the land, all the story we link with, so that's why make me think, like, our forest, our motherland is very important for us. And another thing, in my family and the people in my village, so like they will believe, because before they don't have the religions, so they will believe in the spirits. So before and after go for the farming, so they will do the ceremony to thank and wish the spirits protect their farm, like protect, like not make the any harm come to their land, any people come to destroy their land and get good product agriculture. Yeah, so every year we will do before and after. And another thing that is our traditional knowledge, and now we have the research confirm that this is a sustainable agriculture. Even the Thai government disagree with us, but we already have research that this this is the one of traditional knowledge, and it is the the sustainable development. Yes, this one we call that rotational farming. Like my village, every year, whole family, whole village, so we will go to the do the farm together. And another year we move to another place, and together, of course, the plant we will take really, very large. And another year we go to another place. Before we take 7 years. After 7 years, we will come back the first year. So it means that when you come back the first years, so the, how to say, like the tree, the plant, everything will come up, will come become like a rich environment again. So we no need to use the chemical. Yeah, but now this this traditional is very less because of the policy of the government, they not allow us to move to every year. They just want us to stay the same place every year. So that's why our product is not really good. So many villages have to use chemical. And just only one farm, like they put everything, chili, vegetable, rice, they will put together. So like not just only one kind of the thing they planted. And another thing that this one we call that forest ordination. Every year in the village, we will do like tie the yellow rope with the tree. So because in Thailand now more and more the main religion is Buddhist. So when the yellow rope type the tree, it means that tree become the monk. So you have to respect. You cannot cut down it. They're not allowed. If you do that, it means that you break the law. You break the rule of the community. So they will have something. Yeah. So that's my memory when I was child. But now what happened in my community and the Mekong regions? As you know that in our region, mostly indigenous people, we stay in the top of mountain or near the river. So mostly they will stay in the rich environment. So now more and more the Thai government come to take their community to become national park. Even that community stay really long time ago before the national park, but the government said that is illegal. They have no land title. So this is an example that when they come to take the indigenous community, they move the community to the city. No land, no rights, no farm. Of course, they lost many things, and also that they destroy, they burn their land, they burn their house. Yeah. So, and this guy is the young leader of the community. So he stand up to say that you cannot do like that. Is it abuse human rights? So now he disappears. We cannot find him. Already 3 years. So we're really sure that because of the government, but we have no evidence say that the government, but now still in the process of the court. And also that, as I mentioned earlier, that the indigenous people will stay along the river. So this one is now we fight for Mekong River. Mekong River, most 99% they are indigenous people stay with the Mekong River. So now more and more the government, the company, not only in Thailand, in another country come to want to build the dam. Of course, a lot of problems happen now. And another one is mining. So they said that is a one development project that can help our country. Of course, a lot of impact happened. Some of them lost their family, and especially the children when they grow up with sickness since they're born until they die. And also that a lot of problems happen with our children. And now what we work, how do we work with? So now more and more children stand up, and that's why we work with the children and youth from six countries. Mostly they are indigenous people from China, from Vietnam, from Laos, Myanmar, Thailand, and Cambodia. Because we think that now young people is very important, young people voice is very important. We have to stand up to protect our future. Because okay, they build the dam now, but we have to stay long life. We have to stay whole life of our life. Yeah, so that's why our friend to stand up for their life. And my work is we work. I focus on the ecological child rights. Why I have to focus on the ecological child rights? Because some country in Mekong region, six countries, some country cannot talk about human rights, like China. No, they not allow. You should not talk about human rights. Like Laos cannot talk about the dam, cannot against the dam, cannot protest the dam. You have to listen to me only. So that's why we think that, okay, every country care about the children. So we use ecological child rights and link with the development project. We think that if development project get impact to the children, it means that you abuse child rights. Okay, you not abuse human rights, but you abuse child rights. And also we strongly believe that all the children have right to participation on any development project because it's their rights. So, yeah, it's a one example that many children become grow up with sickness. Many children become child labor. Many children become the child trafficking. Many children become stolen children. Of course, after the they build a dam, they build any development project, they lost their traditional knowledge. Of course, they lost their childhood, their livelihood. They not enjoy with their life anymore. Yeah. And also that we strongly believe that ecological child rights is child rights. And also that we believe that child rights are human rights. And the last one, we believe that environmental rights is child rights. Yeah, so in our regions, for the women, it's very, very important, very difficult to stand up, to say that I can be the leader, because based on our culture, based on our society, so they're not really agree with that the woman also can be the leader. The woman can stand up. You know, like a very difficult. So yeah, so now we try to work more and more with indigenous women, come to train, empower them to get the skill to stand up, to protect their children, to protect their community, to protect their life. Yeah, so many young women now stand up. So after they get the skill, they try to advocate in their community, in their country, and also in another level, in the policy level. Yes. So all of this when we work together now, we this one of the voice of the youth and the student demand to the our state, every state in 6 country. We say that we think that the student is very important. Our children is the sensitive group. They cannot protect themselves any harm, but we have to stand up. We have to protect themselves. And also that we think that if we not protect our children today, but our children will be, in the future, our children will become our leader. Our children will become our government to develop our country. But how can, how do they become the good leader if they are missing the education, they are still a student, they are child labor, they have no skill to be our good leader, our quality leader. So that's why we think that it's very important. We think that all the children, and even also we try to invite all the adults, all the state, to think this issue very important. And also there is one voice of our youth and the students said that we strongly believe we can change our future by our hand. Thank you.
I think we have time for one question or comment, if there's any. Yeah, we have one more presenter. Yeah. Okay. Oh, no, yeah.
Because the indigenous people we stay, because in Thailand, only in the city they have a land title. Yeah, in the mountain, in the rural area, they have no land title. That's why one day the government comes said that no, because you have no rights to take this land because you have no document, so you have to move. Now this place become national park. You have to move. So. You know, like, yeah, so now, okay, we in the research also said that every place, if the indigenous stay in that place still rich environment. When become national park, they destroy the tree. That's the, we already have the research said that, but the government, you know, when they take the plan, they make a, they try to build a dam because if the the community stay there, so it's not easy to build a dam or do any projects with that place. Yes.
Mahalo.
Thank you.
So I'd like to invite Paulina Sholbaeva. Again, she's a Selkup. Oh yeah, we gotta put the microphone on. Selkup woman from Central Siberia in Russia. And I know she's gonna share a little bit more about this, but one thing I've learned about some of the indigenous peoples in Russia is that they have these informational centers. So she was real excited to come to the Ma'ili Learning Center. But when she saw how big it was, she said, oh, but my center is like this room over here. But she was just really excited to see like how all the babies are here for school and just learning more about that. Because that has been one way that they can educate their people over here. Educate their people is through some of their information centers.
Yeah. I have my note. I'm sorry, my English not so good like yours. It's my not my native languages. Yes. My name is Polina Shulbaeva. I'm from Indigenous people from Central Siberia. My full name, Apolinaria Alexandrovna Shulbaeva. It's very biggest. But yeah, but Polina, is it okay? I'm Selkup. We are living here. It's north part of Siberia in the Arctic part. And this is map, it's very interesting because it's a map of indigenous peoples in Russia. Pink color, it's all Russians and another not indigenous peoples place where live. And another color, green, violet, and blue, and different. It's all indigenous places when indigenous live in Russia. But this is all territory, it's federal. In Russia, we have not land. We live here, it's our historical land, but not officially. We have 41 indigenous nations. It's Siberia, Arctic part of Russia, and Far East, it's Kamchatka and Sakhalin. 41 indigenous nations with absolutely different type of culture. My central, it's central for support of indigenous peoples of the North Siberia and Far East. I'm coordinator I'm coordinator of work with conventional biological diversity and different work with protection, tradition knowledge, with nature and other. We have center for, our center have Russian indigenous training center. We will do different type of work like capacity building training, practices in practices with traditional knowledge from generation to young generation, from elders to youth. And we work with absolutely all indigenous, with men, women, elders, young, youth, with every. This is very interesting schema I want to show you. It's traditional knowledge. What does mean traditional knowledge? It's absolutely all. We can lost one type. If you lost one, you lost every. Because this is working only together. If we talked about biodiversity, we talked about spirituality, about agriculture, health, food, and every. And very important when you're talking with peoples in a local level on land, sometimes they not understand what is traditional knowledge. They use it every day, and they not understand how it's important. This is knowledge or practices, and it's what we work with women, how we can use and how we can transmit this knowledge for next generation. It's our one of the type of our work. It's work with issue on climate change, because in Arctic part and North part, it's very big influence and impact on climate change. This is a workshop for indigenous women, youth, and in Moscow. It's this May. This is indigenous from different region of Russia and from different nations, indigenous nation of Russia. And this is Sami reindeers and different deers nations. Oh, I'm sorry. And mammals hunters and fishermen. Different type of indigenous, because I think you understand what is climate change in your territory. My territory is absolutely different. It's no spot, it's many ice, it's not so beautiful or so green territory. But my territory is very beautiful too, because I have many wetlands, many bears, many wolves, bears, you know, absolutely another world. For me, when I come into Hawaii, I said, Malia, it's like another planet for me. Oh my God. I was first 2 days, I'm seeing windows, that was shocking. It's true. and on climate change, because climate change right now it's big influence for reindeer herder. You know, our reindeer, it's 1,000 reindeers and one big family who migrate with 6 months in one way and 6 months in another. And sometimes it's very big surprise for this family when they go in and see some territory in the Arctic place with absolutely changes. 5 years ago, this was tundra, now this is lake or something else, you know. I don't remember, I'm sorry. It's in English, it's permafrost. It's a big problem right now with permafrost because our in the Arctic place, all our villages stay in permafrost. And we have climate change is very, very, how is it? In different places have different change. Some place without change, some places is plus six in the Arctic. Plus six in the Arctic, it's catastrophe. It's permafrost is, we lost permafrost, it's melts. And all villages move in a, like a, under lake or something else. It's, and it's very big catastrophe in the autumn. Because it's, you know, our territory have temperature like a minus 20, minus 30, minus 50 degrees Celsius, not Fahrenheit. It's another system. It's very cold. Yes. And it's a big, big important issue for us. Another, it's elders, two elders in the Arctic, that child, that learning child for traditional knowledge. This is traditional knowledge on health and traditional medicine. How using different type of dry mushrooms or dry berries or traditional medicine. And this is a traditional carving of reindeer leisure. And without my dress, traditional, because it's very heavy, it's leisure. And it's not for this country, yes. It's very big part of our work. It's traditional, not only traditional connection between protection with protection areas, but in traditional how we protect our knowledge in other knowledge. It's a child who working together. This old child before in our tradition, old child before one, before they before 7 maybe years old, were learning together. After that, little bit separated, girls with women, boys with men. But all our child learning one knowledge about how you connect between connect with reindeer, how you can use what you can use in this territory or this territory, traditional calendar and another, because in this territory, in this extremal measure, absolutely all have one rights, and men's and women's. It's what I want. This is very nice pictures because this is very happy children. They eating raw meat. It's was killed maybe 5 or 10 minutes ago, and it's very healthy for us. It's very important part of our culture. We not eating this every day. Not one time or year or two time or in a year. Why? Because in the north part. You know, we have a polar day and polar night. Is it mean, what is polar day? 6 months day. What is polar night? 6 months night without sun. Is it mean no vitamins? We have not plants or something else. We needed some elements for our life. This is very important. When you're drinking blood and eating raw meat, and I said, Malia, my favorite food here, what I tasted, it was raw fish. It was amazing. We're eating raw fish too, a lot of time, really. This is children's. Deer for us, it's a basis of life. This is child, yes, it's one of the nomadic school. It's how I say it, men's with it's winter fishing, and men's learning these children's how to fish. The same doing women, but with girls in a chum, what you can cooked for every. And we one more. We have we did some project. And now we create some books about traditional food, Arctic food. I mean, it's Arctic. I mean, it's not using for you because it's we have another continent, but for Arctic, it's very important. What is traditional food? It's very interesting book with recipe, traditional recipe. How you can dry this fish, or how you can do in some flour for and making fish bread, and very interesting book. This is one of our project about salmon protection. This project very important for indigenous people of far east of Russia. It's Kamchatka, Sakhalin. I'm showing before. It's project not only about protection salmon, it's project about ceremony of salmon too. Because for these peoples, salmon, it's all life. It's a languages, it's a food, it's a ceremony, it's absolutely all. It's all type of knowledge. And first, before we open fish season, first of all, it's a ceremony. And this is what they do after. It's a dress, it's a fish skin. Full, absolutely fish skin. It's a special instrument, traditional instrument for fish skin. Because it's very important that fish, you are not only eating. It's for Far East to indigenous. It's all life, I said. It's impossible. You can see this very quality, and it's maybe you can do this, and your next five generation can use this because it's very very high quality. Yeah, and what I'm saying to you.
Cute Jetty's babies. We love pictures of babies.
Oh, thank you.
And good food too. So we have till 7:20. So we have a few more minutes if anybody has questions or comments for Paulina. Okay. Oh, we get one. And then we come back to you. Go ahead.
Yeah, if with permafrost, it's the biggest problem right now. But I know that in one place in Russia, I won't show the map. I'm sorry. Yeah, and this is living two indigenous peoples, and this boundary have big problem with permafrost. and peoples, they stay in this territory. They said, is it our traditional land? What we can do? If we go in for another place, how we can live? And some government from this part of Russia said, oh, you can go in and live in a city, we can buy for all of you some new houses in a city. And they said, what? I'm sorry, but it's impossible for all of us. It's only 800 people live in this village. There is no, every said no, because is it mean we must kill all our reindeers? We must stop it all our traditional life. And what we do, what we will do in the city? Drinking alcohol? And they stay in this territory. Some peoples maybe migrated some kilometers left or right, but staying, yes, nobody not going.
Because you mentioned that there's not a lot of plants, like yeah. Especially during the winter time. Mm-hmm. And so what do you use for traditional medicine?
We using mild. This is liver and mild. Mild. I have this, I'm sorry, in English. It's bile.
Bile.
You know bile? Fish bile and deer bile, it's very expensive in China, and they buy in Russia, but we have this free because we live in this territory. Yes, we're using bile, we're using mushrooms, we're using berries. We have 3 months summer. 3 months for us, it's okay, because very short spring. It's like 3 weeks. After 3 weeks, no snow, every greens, you know. And for traditional medicine, we're using many wetland berries and wetlands herbs. Because is it our territory? We know absolutely all. When this I can eat, this can eat in some deers, this dogs, this is something, this is for my anti-pain, you know, this is for anti-tuberculosis or something else. We know this. Is it knowledge generation to generation, what we have from our elders? Bile? We using bile anti like a antihistamine, you know.
Oh, antihistamine.
Yeah.
For breathing.
Yeah, and we using like parasite. Because we eating many raw fish, anti parasite is it? It's it's not dry. Dry bile, it's using for like anti-tuberculosis, because it's the north part, it's very cold, anti-flu. But if it's fresh, you put from fish and drink this. It's anti-parasite, yeah. We have many different type of knowledge, on medicine knowledge, of course. No. In Russian, Indigenous people have very short life. Yes, I don't know, because it's very extreme territory, I know why, yes. But but you know, sometimes in an Arctic place with absolutely clear territory, it's 80 or 90 years old, but sometimes when mining company, oil, gas company, we have diamond company, golden company, you know, problem. In the central of Siberia, we have a chemical company. It's okay, it's maybe 40 or 50, yes. It's very short, yes. Different type, big difference.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
Yes. So the elder picture that you show, what is the name of their, what are they called? They're indigenous people, I know, but what are they called?
Nationality? Nationality?
Like it's your
yeah, I'm Selkup. Is it Nenets? Selkup. I'm asked, yes, this is Nenets. And this is Chukotka. Chuk, yeah, because we, I show you a map. We live in like this. Oh, like this. And my people. And we are fishermen, and we are reindeer, because we have like this part, not like one small pieces. And all part of Arctic, after polar cycle, is reindeer herder. From it's like from Sami to Chukotka. It's all reindeer herder. This is mammal hunter, fisherman, fish river, and pastoralists. Thank you.
Thank you. I think she mentioned earlier too that there were 41 different indigenous groups. So, yeah, that's a lot of different diversity. Thank you, Paulina. And thank you to Dada as well as Yeshing.